Okay, in this video, I'm going to look at implementing OpenAI's new function calling system and models with LangChain to actually build a bot that we can ask it different kinds of questions, and it will use different tools to find out the information that we want here. So to kick it off, I'm basically going to be building a simple sort of finance bot. We're going to use the Yahoo Finance API. And we're going to allow users to basically ask questions about the price of a stock, how much the stock has changed over a certain period of time, and then to be able to compare a few stocks to find out which one is the best performing over a particular time here. So, okay, of course, we're using OpenAI. You will need your OpenAI key in here. I've done this one just using the GPT 3.5 Turbo because I think that's what most people will be using rather than GPT-4. So the first thing is to understand what actually happens in the OpenAI functions. So this is their example from their documentation, is that basically a function is going to be a list of functions, and each function is just going to be an object where we've got a name, a description for the function. Now, the description is pretty important because it sort of helps the OpenAI model to actually decide whether to use this function or not. And then we've got the parameters for this. So this is basically what are going to be the inputs that the GPT model have to decide to put into this function to get out. So we looked at in the last video, this idea of this get weather, where we basically have a location and we have a format or a unit of how we're going to be measuring that. So the temperature here. And that in this case, it was an enum of Celsius or Fahrenheit for this. And so we can then decide what is required and what is not required. So there will be certain functions where you will just default to some variables. And so you don't need the model to give you all of the inputs to the function. And there are going to be certain functions where you need all of them. All right. So let's just look at setting up Yahoo Finance. I'm going to start off with just a really simple example using one tool for doing this. We're going to go through it manually, and then I will go through putting it into an agent. I'm using it as an agent in here. So we're going to be looking at getting a stock price, and this basically takes in a ticker symbol in here. So you can see it looks up the ticker symbol and then basically gets the price at the close or whatever the last close was here. So if we look at Apple, we can see we get this price. If we look at Google here, we can get this. Now, here's an interesting challenge, right? With a normal NLP task, we'd have to think about, okay, the user's not going to be able to know these tickers off by heart, right? There's a good chance that they won't know those. So in this case, we're actually using the sort of knowledge that's built in to GPT 3.5 or GPT-4. Of knowing that this means Apple. And then if it's asked to give the ticker symbol for Apple, it should give this. If it's asked to give the ticker symbol for Google, it should give this. So that's the sort of basic setup of the finance part. We're then going to basically bring in some tools. So you've seen me do tools like this before. This has actually changed. The DuckDuckGo search has changed the way they do it now. But just the idea of that you bring some things in, you can then define a tool quite simply like this. We're actually going to build some custom tools. So you can see we're using the Chat OpenAI API. So this is what we're going to be using for the actual model as we go through this. We're actually going to build a custom tool. And so we're going to inherit from the base tool for this. Now, one of the challenges for getting this right is that you have to basically be able to tell the GPT model how it should provide the data back. So if you've seen my video on outparsers, we talked about the Pydantic class as a way to define what the model should give back. And that's exactly what we're doing here. We're using a Pydantic class that we're going to pass in to this tool as the argument schema. Now you will need this. Otherwise, you'll get errors from when it basically compiles down to the functions. So you need a definition of what you expect back, and it needs to require that you've got a description for that as well. So you can see here that this tool is basically just going to be get stock ticker price. The description is going to be that it's useful for when you need to find out the price of a stock. You should input the stock ticker used on the YFinance API. And then you can see here that the model is going to just return back that it wants this function and that it's going to then input the stock ticker in here. And I'm just passing this in to use the function that we defined up here for this, for calling the API and getting the response back. So let's go through it. Now, this is how you would have perhaps done it in the past, but if you do it like this now, it won't work, right? You need your best to do it like this. Make sure you pass in the argument schema as you go through this. So LangChain doing this manually. All right. So first off, we need to think about that we're using the chat model. This requires that we use the user that we, this requires that we use the roles that are built into this. So remember, there's a user role, there's an assistant role. LangChain there talked about as the human message, the AI message. And then we've got a new one, which is the function message. So this is what we use for returning the result of the function. So see, if we go through this, this is the original example that they gave in some of the LangChain documentation for this of a move file tool. You want to get something where you get this kind of JSON out, which is going to be your function definition. And they've actually added a new format tool to OpenAI function in here, right? That's part of the tools that we're going to be using here. Now, we're not going to use it for the move file tool. We're going to be using it for this stock price tool. So we've instantiated the stock price tool here. We've passed it into a list of tools. And then basically, we're just manually converting each of the tools in that list to be this OpenAI function format here. And if we actually look at this function, we can see that this is what OpenAI wants. We've got a JSON object where we've got the name, we've got the description, we've got the parameters, just how it wants it to go in there. Like when we looked at the GetWeather example above this. So now I want to basically make a human message. So the human message I'm going to pass in is what is the price of Google stock? And along with this, so now I pass in a list of human message, AI message, function messages. Those sorts of things can go in this list. But I also now pass in the list of functions, which is what I've got here. That's what we've just made up there. So we're using now model predict messages where we're passing in these messages, right? And it will give us back the AI message. And we can see when we look at the AI message, there's no content in it. It hasn't given us an answer. It hasn't said this is what the price is or anything like that. What it has done though is in the additional arguments, it basically given us a function call argument, which is basically telling us, I want you to call this function. The name of the function is going to be get stock ticker price. And the arguments that it's going to pass in is stock ticker and then Google. So see that I didn't tell it Google. It worked that out itself, that this is the stock ticker for Google. It then basically, we've got that out. Now, if we look at that, those additional arguments, we can see that they break out like this. This is just JSON, right? We can then basically use this to load, you know, this into JSON. We can get the arguments out. So we've got stock ticker, Google, and we then can run the tool. So this is manually running the tool. So we're basically just saying, this is the tool, because there's only one tool in there. So it's just the tool at position zero. And I'm passing in these arguments that we got out here. And you can see, sure enough, it's gone and got the price for the Google stock in here. And in fact, if we look at this, at this time, Alphabet stock is 123.83. And so that's exactly what we got back here. All right. We now basically need to pass that back to OpenAI. And we do that by not passing it as a human message or an AI message. We pass it back as a function message. So the function message here is just going to be a function message with the name of the function that we called, and then the result that we got back. So this was the result that we got back. We pass that in, and you can see that if we define this, this is what it would look like. The content would be this, There was no additional arguments in this case, and we basically passed back the name of the function. So now when we compile this, our next call to the model, we pass in the initial human message, the AI response that we got back. So that's an AI message. We pass back this function message that we got back, and we still pass in the functions in here. And now it's going to give us an answer back. And so this is going to be an AI message back. And if we look at it, sure enough, we get back the current price of Google stock is $123.83. All right. So it used this information and the other information that it already had to create this final response here. Now, that was doing it all manually. So this is like the long way to go through it. We can just put it in an agent. And this is where it becomes much easier. So you'll see that for the agent, I basically just define the model. So I've got the model here. I basically set up and initialize an agent. The agent is going to take in the tool, the LLM, and then the agent type is the new part here. So the agent type here is going to be an OpenAI function agent. So this is key thing to pass in there. Once we've defined that, we can now just run it and ask, okay, what is the price of Google stock? And sure enough, it basically goes through, it invokes the function, it gets the result, it passes that back, and then we get our final result out, the current price of Google stock, and it gives us put the ticker symbol in there as well, and it gives us that price there. So this is how it works. I'll show you a multi-one in a second. Let's just look at the advantages and disadvantages of these. The advantages is that we're probably getting better reasoning and better tool selection than just using React or tool former prompts in that case, because we're actually using a model that OpenAI has trained specifically for doing this. So that's one of the advantages that we've got. The other advantage is that it's probably using less tokens overall, because we're not having to do a lot of in-context learning and pass through examples of, oh, here's another example of getting a stock and this is what you should pass back and those sorts of things like we do with React there. The disadvantages, I would say the disadvantages are pretty small. Basically this is going to be not as easy to customize via prompt if it doesn't work. So if we find that it's not working here, with React, we would just go in, we'd play around with a prompt, we'd find a prompt that could get it working. We can't really do that in this case here. It also, okay, then the other, another disadvantage would be that it locks you into an open AI way of doing it. My guess is we'll start seeing open source models that use this system as well. But at the moment, if you were to transfer this agent to an open source model, you'll probably find it's not going to work very well. So that's something to be aware of. It's locking you into this way of doing it. And then finally, you still need tokens for the tool functions and descriptions. So we're still using some of those. Now, I'm not 100% sure whether they count to your overall tokens. I presume they would, because they're going to go into the model. But that's something that I'm not sure if OpenAI has actually disclosed yet. So what if we want to do multiple tools? So here I'm going to add some new functions to our financial chatbot. We're going to have our price change percentage where we pass in a ticker and then the days ago, and it will basically work out what the price change is. So you can see if I get the price change for Apple over the last 30 days, it's going to be 6.5% there. And then the other one I'm going to put in is we want to get the best performing stock amongst a group of stocks. So this is basically where I pass in a list of tickers, and I tell it how many days to check over, and it will then be able to come back and tell me that, okay, this stock was the best stock out of these three over the last 90 days in this case. So how do we do it? So again, we just make our tools. We've got those functions there already. So we make our tools with our pedantic input descriptions here of what is actually going to go into the model. And then we basically define the class here. So this is for the percentage change in here. And then this one is going to be for the best performing one. We're going to pass in a list of stock tickers there. And you can see now, if we look at the tools, we've actually got quite a few tools in there because we're basically instantiating each of these. Now, we don't need to create the functions here because we're using the agent to do this. It's going to do that for us automatically. We're just going to pass in the tools. So I've got my tools. I define my model again, create and initialize a new agent, passing in tools, passing agent type. And now we can ask multiple questions and you'll see, now we ask, okay, what is the price of Google stock today? We get the same as what we got before. Has Google stock gone up over the past 90 days? And you see, yes. So you see what that actually did was it returned back the stock ticker and it returned back the number of days. And we can see that it's gone up 23.44%. And so it gives us the answer back. Yes, Google stock has gone up by this much. Now, here's the cool thing. So our function is defined for days. So what happens if I ask the model, how much has Google stock gone up over the past 3 months? It can work out itself to convert that to days. So it's taken the 3 months and converted it to 90 days. And sure enough, it gives us the same response back. So this is the advantage of using a large language model for this kind of thing, is that it understands the difference between months and days. It's able to do conversions for that. And it understands also that your function needs a number of days that it can't take in 3 months for that. So if we asked over the past month, my guess is it's going to return 30 days back for something like that. What about if we ask it, okay, which stock out of Google, Meta, Microsoft, and here I've given two of them as the full names and one as the ticker symbol, has performed the best over the past 3 months? Sure enough, it works out that it should go for best performing, passes in the actual tickers, and it will, again, it will convert 3 months to 90 days. It comes back that the stock that has performed the best over the 3 months out of these three is Meta, with a return of 32.4% there. So just to check that, I asked it, how much has Microsoft stock gone up over the past 3 months? See, it went up by 21%, and we know from Google's was 23.4%. So in this case, it looks like it's gotten the right answer, with Meta being the best performing one. Now, you could imagine that we could have lots of different tools and lots of different ways to query this API. And very quickly, we could build up a conversational agent that could answer almost all questions about this. And I'm even curious to see if we ask it, there may be some things that it won't be able to do. If we ask it, okay, how much has Bitcoin gone up over the past 3 months? This is interesting because I was expecting that it actually might make an error here, that the stock ticker for Bitcoin would be BTC, but for the Yahoo Finance one, it's actually BTC to USD. And it basically got it, right? So you can use this for comparing crypto stuff to normal stocks and stuff like that. You can ask it about the NASDAQ, the S&P, etc., for doing this. So anyway, this is an example of using the new OpenAI functions API with LangChain, LangChain's new agent for doing this. As always, if you've got questions, please put them in the comments below. If you like the video, please click like and subscribe. I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.